That's literally garbage that you're now charging people for.
Yeah.
We just acapella'd the intro.
'Cause you can't afford it.
Hello, Imperium. Deep in an undisclosed bastion, somewhere on Holy Terra, it's Tabletop Talkerz, where we talk about modeling, gaming, movies, pop culture, and so much more. I'm Lord Commissar Wood, and as always, I'm joined by Josiah the Heavy Flamer Fryer. How you doing today, man?
Doing pretty good, man.
Did you like that little Heavy Flamer Fryer?
Nice touch.
Nice little touch.
How you been doing in the Shield of Ball?
I've been doing pretty good so far.
Yeah?
Haven't played too many games, but I've been doing decent in them.
Yeah.
Almost got my hero apotheosized into a knight.
Yeah, apotheosized east.
I don't know what the
yeah, I don't know
adjective
what the
verb of that is.
Yeah.
Adjective form.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. I saw that you played a 5-way.
Yeah.
Cities of Deathmatch.
5-way. Took advantage of the wording of the knight's ion shield. Little known fact: in a multiplayer game with knights, each of your opponent's shooting phases, according to the wording on Ion Shield, you get to redirect your Ion Shield. Each one.
Yeah.
Meaning even if you're surrounded by different opponents, you can shield each of them.
The way the wording is, I believe, is during your opponent's...
During each opponent's shooting phase.
Yeah.
Ooh.
That stinks. So that was pretty nice. You were able to take advantage of that, and you ended up winning that.
Yep.
By a significant margin, too.
Yeah. By victory points, at least. They wrecked my knights. It was mostly melee stuff that wrecked my nights.
Yeah. I've gotten in some bigger games. I'm going to be posting another game with Lone Wolf Devin.
It's nice.
Pretty cool. I think I played a game against... What was it? I think I posted it on the channel. I believe it was Tyranids. Yeah, I played against Max's Tyranids. Played a Cities of Death match. Went pretty good. It was like all the way right there to the end. He finally got more victory points than I did. I came back. It was like a back and forth kind of match, real bloody. But I think I finally found out how to play this little army. I hope the Scions and Militorum Tempestus have a new codex for 7th edition. They were the first kind of like experimental. What is a 7th edition codex is going to look like?
They should have just been a supplement, in my opinion.
I believe so as well. But now that I'm playing them, I hope they get a new codex. I hope they don't get rolled into Astra Militarum. Because that means I can't play my guys as troops anymore. They're elites, so...
Well, you could make them veterans.
I could. Yeah, I could.
Which is probably more cost-effective.
I'd be back to playing guard. But
you'd be back to playing guard, but... For a while, I was considering playing the Stormtrooper army. This was a couple of editions ago before they had their own book. But
yeah.
They had ways to play them as just Stormtrooper army.
Yeah.
I was considering it, but... get more versatility out of veteran troopers.
Yeah, I just don't want to go back to playing guard. I like playing stormtroopers. I like having the Militorum Tempestus being the only guy at the store that's playing it.
True.
I like having that individuality. I've always been kind of like that. When trends go somewhere, I kind of want to be the guy who's not doing what everybody else is doing.
It makes sense.
Yeah. So I think I've finally come out with a niche. I just hope they come out with another codex, just so I get like another formation. The two that are in there are pretty good, but I like to get like one more.
This formation power creep has started to set in.
Yeah, it has.
You're a little behind.
Mine are very lacking. Yes.
Yeah.
In that power creep, yes. Got to look through the Dark Angels codex. Oh my God, it's so beautiful.
Rock hard.
Oh man. Oh man, I could cut diamond. I was just looking at the different formations, like the one for Belial, where you can end up taking, I believe it's 11 Terminator squads. Just insane. You can take, I believe, in the Samael detachment, you can take up to 11 bike squads. The way I worked it out was, I believe, for 1,000 points, take 3 squads of Raven Wing Knights, 3 squads of bikers, just regular bikes, command squad, Samael, all as a battle-forged army. Yeah.
Nice.
Pretty awesome. I'm really kind of stoked about the cheaper prices. I like that core. I like the way they do the formations. The where you can take the core detachment and you can get the rhinos and drop pods for free. You take 2 of them, I believe, in the Lion's Roar. I forget the benefit. They have a different one for if you take 2 of the core detachments, you get another command benefit.
That's
kind of nice. Yeah. Really cool, man. I'm really liking the way they're doing these new codexes. I'm definitely picking up my Dark Angels codex here sometime probably this week. And start making my Raven Wing.
It's pretty awesome, man.
Yeah, pretty awesome. So, spoilers. Spoilers. If you are watching Star Wars Rebels. Spoilers. We saw episode 1 of season 2, the Siege of Lothal. So spoilers. My God.
Very cool.
Very, very cool. Favorite part? Vader taking on the Rebel fleet in a TIE Advanced. And just, they send out a wave of fighters, he takes them all out, and still attacking capital ships, takes out a capital ship.
My favorite, just individual part,
yeah,
is the Star Fury vector maneuver that he does.
Mm.
Turns around and uses his velocity to just keep at the speed,
yeah,
and shoot
scooting backwards.
Him.
Yeah,
he turns around mid-fight.
We haven't seen any of that in any Star Wars.
That's why I use the Babylon 5 reference.
Yeah. We know Anakin was the best pilot in the galaxy, but
saw the spinning that Anakin did. All the time.
Oh yeah, yeah. He's like. Spinning isn't piloting,
but
it's fun.
Yeah.
He's going forward. He's got two A-wings on his ass. He just flips and is like scooting backwards, blows them both away.
Awesome.
Just
insane. Awesome.
There's a point in it too when Kanan and Ezra first feel Vader, like he feels presence, and Ezra turns around and goes, "Do you feel that?" And Kanan says,
"It's cold."
It's cold. That's awesome.
From the first descriptions we have of Darkseid having a sense to it.
Yeah, yeah.
Feel to it.
Yeah,
a unique feel to it.
Yeah, we've known that the Force was a warmth, but they never mentioned anything about a cold. Yeah, that's awesome. It's like the icy soul of Vader. Pretty cool. So. We're going to move into the segmentum. This is a segment of the show where we come up with random topics that aren't necessarily game-related, so they don't have to be. We wanted to talk about the possibility of Star Wars Hero Clicks.
Okay, so this has been a possibility ever since Star Wars was purchased by Disney.
They have a... I think 5 lines of HeroClix since this purchased Marvel.
And it's been almost every popular movie has had them. Even Lone Ranger had HeroClix. So
that travesty, yeah.
They weren't good, but they were there.
They were there.
So Star Wars HeroClix is a total possibility, especially considering Marvel is making Star Wars comics again.
Yeah. Star Wars comics. Star Wars cartoons. Star Wars toys.
So...
Star Wars Hero Clicks.
There's the obvious implication of what certain things do in the game.
So you're going to have, like, Captain America punching Palpatine in the face.
Yes. But this also is a potential possibility in the comics.
A crossover?
Yeah.
Ah, no!
They don't mix well.
Visually, it's going to look... horrible. Did you like the Doctor Who Star Trek crossover?
Those mix well. Ridiculous levels of technology used on a daily basis. The technology is used to suit the plot. In Star Wars, the plot
The plot is
the plot.
Person-driven.
Yeah,
person-driven.
It is
character-driven. Yeah, character-driven.
Both Doctor Who and Star Trek are sleuth shows.
Yeah.
There's a mystery. Let's solve it.
Okay. I see what you're saying.
They use their techno-babble in place of the smoking room scene.
Yeah.
Classic Sherlock Holmes thing. Hell, but Sherlock Holmes was... Moriarty was in the freaking show.
Yeah.
In both.
Yeah, in both,
Doctor
yeah.
Who and...
Yeah, in, even in false terms, as in Q and the... What is the one guy the Doctor fought? The Master?
Yeah.
Yeah, is Moriarty. I see the Avengers in Star Wars just looking like shit. Just all the color. And
some characters would, while they would pop, like, out on the page, which is what they're intended to do, you get that a lot in the comics to begin with. The Star Wars comics are already, like, visually different.
Yeah, yeah, they
from
are.
From what people are used to in movies.
Yeah, there's a lot of black and white, a lot of drab earth tones. Even in the new movies, we see it in the new previews,
yes.
See those drab earth
there's
tones.
Not a lot of... Varying colors.
Yeah, exactly.
In the movies.
I think that's why a lot of people maybe visually weren't attracted to the new prequels as much as the traditional Star Wars.
Yes.
Because it's so much more colorful and bright
yes.
and in your face.
Not what we're used to.
Yeah, especially Naboo, you know. Look at the Naboo fighting scene. It's so iconic, you know.
Yeah. Also looked like Windows.
Yeah, exactly. I can't look at that without thinking that, you know, a tank
like the
is...
the Toy Federation is invading with
yeah, exactly. It's going to be coming over the hill at any point.
Yeah.
I recently started playing Old Republic again. I like that MMO. It's pretty fun. I just like it really for the fluff. I'm getting a lot of the, you know, Star Wars, like the Insider stuff.
Good question. I'm playing a Jedi. Do you go light side or dark side? Or does it depend on the mission?
When I'm playing a Jedi, I always stay light side, no matter what. When I go Sith, I go all Sith.
I have, in fact, I always read the things and contemplate and try to think about what the actual best option
like
for all
you, party. What you would do, or?
What the right thing to do is.
Okay.
The not so much the light side thing, what the correct for all parties thing in the situation. Because Jedi...
Yeah.
Don't just automatically go light side, like many do. But
yeah.
Like you have to, like the good Jedi think about what would be.
That was more common in the Old Republic.
True.
Yeah.
It was an Old Republic game.
Yeah.
And in Luke's Order.
Yeah. You're more free to contemplate, be a little
yes.
more on the road. Look at Kip always arguing and stuff, but
yeah.
still being a really good person.
Yeah.
But
it's a necessary role.
Yeah, it's a necessary role. The free to play, you find that ever be a hindrance when you play any of these MMOs?
Free to play is only really good when it's not also pay to win.
Yeah.
I
like the level. I don't mind the level cap for the free to play on Old Republic. It gets a little annoying that you can't get the gear. That you should be getting in some of the raids and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And, but I think it's kind of cool, man. It's a lot better than those, like, apps that you download that are like, oh, play this game, but you really need to speed up this shit, so you need coins, so come on, give me
you
money.
You gotta buy money.
Yeah. So it's none of that shit, you know? You just gotta do a whole lot more grinding in an MMO. But the way you can level up if you do pay is a little shitty. Because you got a lot of people who are high level capped. Say, like in the Hut Cartel, I think you get 55. Say you're capped at 55 and you haven't really done the work to get there. You just bought all the shit
yeah.
in the Hut Cartel, you know, to get experience. Because then you can get like the 50% more upgrade, 50% more upgrade. So you're like got 300% more experience for every little thing you do. So, you know, you get a lot of people who don't know the story as well, the fluff. But that's them, dude. I think it's awesome because I get to play to 50 and learn a lot of the story and still
least
do all the
favorite planet.
Stuff. Taurus.
Alderaan.
Yeah. I hated Taurus. I just wanted to get the fuck off of Taurus. Just what are those things? Racks.
Rackles.
Yeah. Ah. Oh, just wanted to get the fuck out of there. I really liked Nar Shaddaa. That was, I think, one of my favorite. Yeah. I think that was one of my favorite. What was your favorite?
Either Nar Shaddaa or Coruscant.
Yeah, Coruscant was cool too. Yeah, Coruscant was cool. That's classic. You know, I remember the first, that's what really attracted me to the episode one, seeing Coruscant for the first time. I was like, oh my god, Coruscant. The city, planet, world thing. So, what did you want to talk about for the segment and segmentum? Movies?
Yes. We need to. What? Alright, so there's been a lot of reboots lately. Reboots coming all along the horizon.
Mm-hmm.
What movies were either. What movies should get remade?
So, we're saying that we hear some of these movies like, what is it?
Ghostbusters.
Ghostbusters, yeah. We're making a girl one and a boy one. They're remaking Jem.
Yeah.
From 80s cartoons.
Like the truly outrageous one.
Truly outrageous. The, dude, just shit movies that they're just saying, yeah, we're going to remake all of them. And I guess the nostalgia factor's hitting in for a lot of people. For, you know, there's people, I guess, who are really stoked about Jem, I guess. But
yeah. You know? I see them online, and they're really happy about it.
I'm not one of them, but yeah, they're there.
Yeah.
But what do we think should be remade? Instead of this crap they're fucking chucking in our mouths. Hollywood's like, here, eat this. You know you fucking want it. We say it came from your childhood, so fucking eat it.
Gremlins.
Gremlins. Like a... Like, now...
Not another, a serious Gremlins.
Another comedic...
Another light-hearted comedy Gremlins.
So Gremlins 1 or Gremlins 2 funny?
Yes. Shit's too serious nowadays.
Alright, so Gremlins 2 funny? Because Gremlins 2 funny was a little more over the top. You had the, they had a little more scary in there, but they also had a little more... Because they had the Rambo...
Yeah, Gremlins 2 funny, but without the talking Gremlins.
No talking Gremlins.
No talking Gremlins. The most we get is the Gremlin ones.
Yeah. So, what Gremlins would you bring back in that movie? If you're going to bring back the Flasher, he's got to come back. That.
No.
Yeah, he was awesome. None of them had any junk, so it's like, what are you flashing? He's just like...
That's true.
You know?
Has to be practical effects, too.
Yeah.
Get Jim Henson on this.
Exactly. Yeah. Whoever's doing the Star Wars puppets, they look amazing. Get him in there.
Yeah.
It's probably Henson.
Yeah.
One of his kin.
The
kin folk.
The company.
Yeah. I'd say bring back the Spider one, too. Because I like the Spider. The
Spider one was cool.
He was cool.
And the Bat one.
Yeah, yeah. He
but
was
make
scary.
Them all, like, Dark Knight-y. He's well, on the other one's like, yeah. He goes.
You could even make the Flasher like just put lipstick on him, like yeah. like
that's just not might be in bad taste.
Yeah, yeah. Because if he, especially if he kills it,
internet too soon.
Yeah, no. Internet, is that okay? If they didn't do such a shitty Clash of the Titans, I would say do a Clash of the Titans remake with practical effects.
You want to talk about shitty Critters.
Ugh. That was a shitty, shitty movie. You could do a cool
that,
one, though.
Now for that, I think they go full Pixar.
Yeah, just Pixar's Critters. Little rolling balls of teeth.
Like when they roll over, you're just like a kind of red skeleton.
Yeah, yeah. I think they get bigger as they eat.
No. They all come, roll up to the big ball. And then,
they form like Voltron.
Yeah.
And then roll
up.
But
the powers combine.
Yeah. I'll form the ball.
I'll form the mouth. I will form the mouth.
I will form the mouth. Well, somebody's going to form the ball. There's got to be a ball.
It's a ball of mouths.
Ball of mouth. A movie from, like, the 80s or you know, like my childhood, because my childhood was the 80s. I'm dating myself. I think something that I would like to see, like a serious take on, would be, I know it sounds kind of cheesy, but Iron Eagle with Louis Gossett Jr. I think it was badass.
Right.
The jet movies. We don't have any like badass jet pilot movies. I think the last one we had was that one about the drone jet.
It's not really...
Hello, Cool J.
Yeah, because that's the thing now. It's all drones.
Yeah. stealth.
What we should do is a modern serious take on The Last Dragon.
Who's the baddest? And that go full CG effects.
Yeah.
Like, he goes Akira when he's like talking.
We use it to make the Dragon Ball movie that Evolution wasn't.
You got Shonuff going Super Saiyan 3.
Yeah.
Super Shogun 3?
Yeah, Super Shogun.
You got... What is it? Do you have the light boy?
Got the glow.
You got the glow, that's it.
You got the glow.
They would have to change the names. They'd be like Bruce Lee and Roy. They'd be like, you bastards. Shonuff's fun.
Yeah.
He's awesome. But Bruce Leroy just sounds a little...
A little racist,
yeah. We'll make him Wesley Snipes. Wesley Snipes as... artist formerly known as Bruce Leroy. The martial artist formerly known as Bruce Leroy.
I would actually pick Wesley Snipes to be shown up.
Wesley Snipes to show up?
Terry Crews.
Terry? Yeah, yeah. Wesley Snipes versus Terry Crews is showing up.
Can you imagine him go, POWER! And then his afro turns gold.
Did you see that video on YouTube of Terry Crews? And they made it look like they hooked all of his muscles up to a sound machine?
Yeah.
So he's like making music. Yeah. It looks badass. That was funny. That was really cool. I've always liked, jet fighter movies. I thought that was badass, dogfighter movies. And Red Tails was shit. That was a crap movie. But, Iron Eagle was a kick ass. I think, that, or... If you're gonna go, 80s cartoons, let's do a serious... Or let's do a cool remake of an 80s cartoon. I'd say you do, Snorkels. The Snorks. Yeah, fuck it, man. Let's just totally rip off. We'll have Neil Patrick Harris.
No.
We'll do exactly word for word the Smurfs movie with Snorks.
Care Bears.
Now, I say for that, you go rated R. Rated R Care Bears.
Like the Care Bear Wars?
Yeah. The Care Wars. And you just have, Care Bear Stare!
You
see the flesh ripping off somebody as the beam hits them. It's just slowly, it's melting them down, maybe Raiders of the Lost Ark, skeleton. When they've seen the...
Go all horror Children of the Corn with it, and the Care Bear Stare is actually... those dead doll eyes. Just looking at you.
Kind of just creepy.
It is.
The penance stare.
Dependent.
Yeah, we'll have the Care Bears stare versus the penance stare one day in the epic battles. Yeah. See which one wins.
No one wants to remember Ghost Rider.
Let's move on to a segment we call Imperial Truth or Heresy. This is where we find laws from all over the country that are still on the books. And I quiz you, and then you're going to quiz me. We're going to figure out what's imperial truth and what's heresy, all right? So, first off, I've got, in Texas, you may not carry your wire cutters in your back pocket. It's weird. I don't know. Maybe people were cutting wires.
Maybe it involved several accidents involving people sitting down and the wire cutters stabbed them or something.
Too many. And they're like, "This, that's enough."
Yep.
One is enough. All right. North Carolina says no to costumed meetings. So you can't have a convention with costumes.
North Carolina says no to costumed meetings.
Yep.
Does North Carolina have convention centers?
They would have to. You would have to have. They just took down the rebel flag, right? And then they made a black dude put it right back. So fucked up. So maybe they don't. They were like, fuck that! We're not having furries here. They saw one furry meeting, a guy like wearing a fox outfit with his genitals hanging out, and they're like,
no.
Put the kibosh on it.
That's what I was thinking too.
Alright, so you may not pump your own gas in New Jersey. It's a law. Can't pump your own gas in New Jersey.
I've heard a lot of bad things about New Jersey, so I believe that.
Yeah. Well, it means that a pump attendant has to do it. So there's a guy who really doesn't want to do it, pumping your gas.
Or this guy is only qualified to pump gas.
What this actually means to me is there's going to be more creepy meetings with people you don't really like. There's like this guy is going to be sitting at the back of your car, like staring at you.
Do you have to tip gas attendants?
It would feel like wrong if you didn't, but it kind of sucks because now you're paying even more for gas. What if you got, hey dude, what about the embarrassing scenario
maybe
when you're down
so
to a little bit of money?
Need Jersey.
Maybe. What about if you're down to like $5, right? And the guy's like, fill her up, and you're like, no, I need like $4.39 in gas. Be a little embarrassing to tell a dude. He's like,
and is it still like such a small percentage tip? Like I got $5 in gas. Do I
that's
need
it.
To do a quarter.
That's why I said you got $5 because you gotta give him a tip. So when you get 35 cents, you're like, here you go, man. All right. So in New Orleans, no cursing. No cursing the fireman while he's working in New Orleans.
New Orleans.
In New Orleans. Now, you know that's the home with that voodoo.
I'll believe that.
A little bit of that cree-cree.
I'll believe that.
All right. Arizonans say no to outdoor dancing. That sounds great. No dancing. No fucking happiness. No show of happiness outdoors.
You don't put baby in the corner.
You don't put baby in the corner.
Footloose. Take off your...
Yeah, that's it. You need Kevin Bacon. He'll fucking change that shit. No hunting whales in Utah.
I believe that, even though it's a landlocked state.
Alright, so... what is it? Southington, Connecticut banned silly string sales. Seems a little extreme.
I do remember when I was a kid... on America's Funniest Home Videos, they were spraying silly string across a birthday cake at the guy who was about to blow them out. Sorry, at their mom who was about to blow them out. Mm-hmm. And that aerosolized string is flammable for several seconds after it.
Really?
So they...
So it's like a blowtorch at their mom?
It was more like the string itself was still covered in the aerosolized chemicals, so it was caught fire over the moving over the birthday cake. And then into her hair.
So more like napalm.
Yes.
Almost. Like fiery goo.
Yes.
Okay, I can see banning this. Makes sense. They're like, listen, some lady burned her fucking face off. Your kids are out having a...
Oh, you imagine that.
Like, you're just like, here, kids, play silly string fire. They're like, hey, the cake. You bring out the cake and the fucking kids just catch fire.
Yep. That's hilarious.
All right, Colorado... law says no couches on the porch. Like, can't be too relaxed on your porch. It's a little too relaxing.
Maybe it's a public image thing.
Could be.
I know several towns with awkward laws about like what color you can paint your house.
Yeah, there's a lot of those places have HOA laws, homeowner association, and they'll say like you can't have any trucks in your yard. Just two cars. You have to have, if you paint your house, it has to be one of these approved colors. You gotta have your grass this high. You know, it's really shitty. Let's sum it up here. Alright, so we've got Texas. In Texas, you may not carry your wire cutters in your back pocket. North Carolina says no to costume meetings. You may not pump your own gas in New Jersey. New Orleans says no cursing a fireman while they're working. Arizonans say no to outdoor dancing. No hunting whales in Utah, which is amazing to me. Southington, Connecticut banned silly string sales. Colorado law says no couches on the porch. And finally, in Washington, you must report your crime ahead of time or face a misdemeanor. So which one do you think is Harris's, sir?
Hmm. I'm gonna go with the wire cutters.
Wire cutters in your back pocket?
Wire cutters in your back pocket.
You still think that's a big enough problem for them to have a lava?
I don't think that's a big enough problem.
It was. Apparently it was in Texas. That's not the heresy, sir. Yeah, it's just not that big a mission.
So what's the imperial truth here?
The imperial truth is that the lie was in Arizona there's no outdoor dancing. It's just in Pinal County, Arizona. For some reason. A little Christian, maybe. They need Kevin Bacon, really.
Footloose.
Four degrees of separation away from Kevin Bacon. Me and you.
Yeah.
Might as well be Kevin Bacon at this point. All right, sir, so your imperial truth or heresy.
Okay. First off, we've got a law. The penalty for jumping off buildings in New York is life in prison.
The penalty for jumping off buildings. So if you live, they're fucking locking you up. They're like, hey, buddy, you're like, yeah. And like, they take your shattered, gooey, gelatin-like arm and put it behind your back.
Yeah. Messed up, man.
It's fucked up. Your corpse serves time.
Right. In Alabama.
Alabama!
Boogers may not be flicked into the wind.
Boogers may not be flicked into the wind.
Got a lot of Alabama ones here.
Mm. I love Alabama.
Yeah. Crazy people. Sometimes.
Sometimes.
Alabama!
Alabama mile!
Also in Alabama, putting salt on a railroad, on railroad tracks, is punishable by death.
Punishable by death. Wow. Salt on the railroad tracks. Maybe they think it's made of slugs? They think it'll shrivel up?
Never know.
Maybe it was like, salt was so valuable, because like, you know, it's worth the salt. That if somebody's just like throwing salt around, that was like making it rain back in the day. They're like, dude, you fucking wasting it.
It is legal to go the wrong way down a one-way street as long as you have a lantern on the front of your automobile.
Oh, wow. So if you have, like...
A lantern!
A lantern. Wow. You get the cars coming at you, it's like, what the fuck? I got a lantern, man. I'd have the Green Lantern.
This one's pertinent. Also, another Alabama one. Men who deflower virgins, regardless of age or marital status, may face up to 5 years in prison.
I could definitely see that one. I could see, because, like, they'd be like, the first time, like, Joe Bob impregnates your daughter, it's like, oh, this guy should be put to death.
Oh, yes.
He deflowered my virgin. My beautiful flower.
And lastly, it's illegal to wear a fake mustache in a church if it's funny.
If it's funny. If it's not funny, it's perfectly fine. Come on, like, that's distasteful. He had a mustache just like that at a funeral, say?
Yeah.
The dead guy's got, like, a handlebar mustache. You wear one, they're like, that's distasteful. You're like, it's legal.
None of the Groucho
it's
Marxes.
Legal. Yeah. The Groucho glasses. With the big nose.
And the mustache.
So, go over them again.
Okay. The penalty for jumping off buildings in New York is life in prison.
It's life in prison, if you live.
In Alabama, boogers may not be flicked into the wind.
Yeah, that one's just suspect, because it's like... But I could see a lot of, like, people like...
Yep.
Hits a judge in the face, he's like...
Also in Alabama, putting salt on railroad tracks is punishable by death.
Okay.
It's legal to go the wrong way down a one-way street as long as you have a lantern on the front of your automobile.
I think they mean the lights that cops use. Like, I think that's what they mean. Maybe they call those lamps or something. But I just see this, like, you know, old rickety lantern with, like, the... candle in it.
Men who deflower virgins, regardless of age or marital status, may face up to 5 years in jail.
Regardless of age or marital status.
And it's illegal to wear a fake mustache in church if it's funny.
If it's funny.
Which one do you think is the heresy here?
Heresy. The booger's awful suspect. death for salt. I could see that being a law that they're just too stupid to take off the books. Flowering virgins, you know, it's the Bible Belt. I can see it happening. I'm going to say the Inquisitor in me, I'm going to summon some Cotez and say it's the Booger in the Wind.
The Booger in the Wind is still a law.
It's still a law.
Still a law.
Holy shit. No snot rockets.
Salt on the railroad tracks dates back to when railroad tracks were made out of pig iron, and salt would just straight up corrode them.
Oh, wow. That's cool. Okay. So, like, eventually this...
Yeah, it will derail
the train. It'll derail this train eventually.
And kill a lot of people.
Yeah.
So...
It's gonna be more sadistic.
Yep.
Al-Qaeda, that's what they did back in the day. The old West Al-Qaeda.
Right. The heresy is actually the first one. The penalty for jumping off buildings in New York is not life in prison, but the death penalty.
Really? If you didn't die,
they're
gonna
die. Yes.
That's awesome. That's amazing. Wow. All right, so we're going to move on to epic battles. This is where we take some characters from different opposing or connected somehow. Factions of different pop culture, and we face them in battle. So the first I've got here is Muhammad Ali versus Tyler Durden from Fight Club.
Muhammad Ali.
Now, Muhammad Ali's got the rope-a-dope, but Tyler Durden can just take it.
Muhammad Ali is a trained fighter. Tyler Durden is a business paper-pusher guy with psychological problems.
Yeah, but he can just take... He beat himself up harder than Muhammad Ali.
He punched himself in the right places to cause bleeding.
Yeah.
Muhammad Ali would knock him out.
Yeah, that's true. Muhammad Ali was a force. He beat Superman.
Yeah, Muhammad Ali beat Superman.
He did, he beat
Superman. Goku cannot say the same thing.
No. All right, so... Predator versus Spawn. So, there's a dark alley, and the Predator, it's like, it's a hot month, it's the hottest month it's been.
It's funny, because they both bleed bright green.
Yeah. The, and I figured they're both, because, you know, Spawn uses a lot of guns, and Predator's got
guns.
Shit tons of guns.
And blades.
And blades, and he's got the chains, and his cape. The cape
Spawn can heal himself.
Yeah, Predator's got that fucking kit. He just staple,
that's
squirt,
a
squirt.
Field kit. Like,
but it seems to work better than other field kits.
It's a high-tech field kit, but it still takes time for him to do. Spawn can just concentrate, spend a few of his limited amount of magic
his destiny points.
Yeah. And
his health
we're
points.
Talking Al Simmons, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
All right.
We're talking Al Simmons.
Okay.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, Black guys do better against Predator.
They do, historically.
In an urban environment, too, because there's no way you get Spawn to go to a jungle.
Yeah.
I'm going to give it to Spawn. As much as I like think Predators are awesome and whatnot, I'm going to give it to Spawn.
I think, actually, Predator in this one. Because Predator's got the cool, different... visions, you know what I mean? Like heat vision, thermal vision,
Spawn
all the different...
teleport and has magic.
Yeah, but he's it's all limited. You know, he's pretty limited. And if he takes a lot of damage, he takes one of those fucking blasts from that shoulder gun from the Predator, that thing blows holes like this, you know? That thing's going to blow a hole in Simmons, and he's going to have to concentrate really hard, spend a lot of that shit to heal that up. While the Predator's got the double-fisted claws in his face.
Yeah.
I'd still
give it to Spawn, though.
I think it depends on how it starts. I think if Spawn was...
Want to know why? Batman fought Spawn to a standstill. Batman beat every Predator he encountered. So it stands to reason that Spawn could beat a Predator if he fought the guy who beat all the Predators to a standstill.
Yeah. He is a military dude as well.
Yeah.
Military Special Forces, Hitman, CIA, all that shit. Yeah. Alright, so, yeah, we'll give it to Simmons. You talked me out of it. Alright, so, my last battle is Gandalf v. Doctor Strange.
Ooh. Lord of the Rings magic, I would say, is less powerful than Marvel
comic book magic. I would say so, too. Yeah, I would say...
So we're in agreement here, Doctor Strange?
I would say Doctor Strange. You could take him into another dimension where Gandalf wouldn't really be able to comprehend. He'd get his balance quicker than the average person.
Yeah, because he's not like he's human.
But you go into some of these places where up is down and down is up, Gandalf's like, what the fuck? I'm used to running through the woods, slaying things with a physical sword. You know, he can summon ghost swords and a demon army. You know, the... Yeah. I would say Doctor Strange...
Hands down.
It's fucking down. Even though it's Benedict Cumberbatch is going to play him.
Ugh. Yeah.
Been in big Cumber can act. I just want to say this, that keeping your head still and moving your mouth really dramatically is not acting. You're con. This is how I act.
But keeping your head still and saying fancy words while moving your hands dramatically is very Doctor Strange.
Yes, yes.
So
who's going to do that? Not him.
Hopefully him.
Let me. I am Doctor Strange. This is how I act. I just move my mouth very dramatically. I will summon this sword to come out. Alright, sir, so do you have some epic battles for us to face up?
Alright, so first up, Captain America versus Captain Darton Lysander of the Imperial Fists.
Of the Imperial Fists.
Of the Third Company.
Oh, man. So we've got Hammer on Shield.
With Hammer and Shield and Terminator armor.
And Terminator armor versus Shield.
Super Soldier wearing it.
Yeah. I think Lysander. With and I tell you because I think that vibranium isn't going to help you with everything else. He's going to throw the shield. It can hit Lysander right here. Right there. And he's like, "Oh, you fucker!" And he's just gonna smack him with the hammer. You know, it's not gonna. What he can do with the shield isn't gonna hurt Lysander whatsoever.
He would see the armor. He would have to stay behind him because there are limit. He would use the limitations of Terminator armor. It's not like Captain America hasn't fought dudes in armor before.
Yeah, yeah.
But it would come down to like he breaks the armor,
which I don't think he could do. They walk out of a spaceship and fall from orbit to Earth to test it, see what it's like.
Yeah.
Okay, this works. Captain America isn't going to be able to manhandle that thing open.
No, he's not.
So,
like, he can get in some good
Lysander now does keep his helmet off.
Yeah.
So, he'd be face-to-face with Cap.
Well, I figure if he can throw the shield and it does enough damage to a freaking, like, vehicle to cause a part of it to explode. Him punching with the shield, it's got to have some decent force. I'm not talking AP2.
We're talking about Ceramite, though, you know?
Oh, we're talking Terminator, and we're talking about adamantium.
Yeah, adamantium, which is superior metal to vibranium.
It depends on whether it's Antarctic vibranium or Wakandan vibranium, actually. Antarctic vibranium reacts with adamantium by making it explode.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Well, hopefully it wouldn't be that. Sander just like one shield throw, kaboom!
Well, it's clearly Wakandan vibranium with the references to Wakanda.
So I say that he couldn't do any damage with the shield enough to hurt.
In the comics, though, it's also got a little bit of guru in it now. Because the dwarves of Nalvdavir reforged it.
Yeah. Still, I don't think he could do. I don't think he could physically throw it hard enough to hurt Terminator armor or hurt.
Oh.
Even if he hit Lysander, I'm saying right in the head. He has his helmet off. Boom! I don't think it's going to hurt him enough to stop Lysander from hurting him.
A guardsman can hurt him. With luck, a guardsman can. Would you not say that he is at least, if not superior, to a guardsman?
Yeah, he's like a neophyte. Or an initiate, you know.
Okay.
He would be the first stage when he first got the first organs.
Okay. So, like, the first things is, the first stage of becoming a Space Marine is they put you in that tank from the first Captain America movie.
Yeah.
Okay, alright, I'll give you Lysander.
Yeah.
You've convinced me.
Alright.
I was neutral on this, because Captain America has quite a bit of plot armor.
Yeah, he does. But he's been beaten several times, and beaten, like, roundly beaten.
Yes, soundly defeated.
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, the next one. Brunor Battlehammer.
Oh!
Versus Gimli, Son of Glowin.
Oh my goodness! My favorite two dwarves in the entire world. Brunor Battlehammer.
Versus Gimli, Son of Glowin. No elf friends.
I know I want Brunor to win. But let's discuss this, like, for reals.
First off, gotta bring up the racial superiority of dwarves in Lord of the Rings setting versus dwarves in Forgotten Realms.
Yes,
setting.
Yes.
They are physically, not necessarily mentally, because the dwarves of Forgotten Realms setting are human, if not superior, intelligence, because they develop technology.
Yeah.
Whereas the dwarves of fanciful forges, but still very simple machines.
More magical.
Yes.
And, you know, stuff.
And
theme. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Technologically, but I think strength and
Forgotten Realms dwarves don't universally suffer from that gold curse.
Yeah. They also Forgotten Realms dwarves face more bloody combat on a more regular basis. J.R.R. Tolkien has, like, big battles and then long times of peace, and you got, like, just them, like, kind of money grubbing, and then a big war for
still
a small amount of time. And it's like, I think all of the Lord of the Rings, took 1 year, from the Fellowship to the Mordors, 1 year. That's not long. Like, at any point, bandits from the Spine could come out, and they have to fucking...
If anything, took Brunor longer to make his elf friend than... Gimli.
Yeah. And it was more, that's a battle for another day. So, well, I say Brunor. And I say because, I think you can discourage Gimli. Gimli's, been like, fuck, we need to get out of here. And Brunor's not that kind of dude. Brunor's like, well, this is exactly what I want. I'd love to die like this.
Yeah.
You know, let's run in there. Come on, this is fun! You know, he's going to fucking start laughing. And, you know?
You're giving it to Brunor?
I'm giving it to Brunor. And I love him so much.
Despite the physical superiority of the... Well, not necessarily know that Gimli is physically superior.
We haven't seen him side by side. We just seen him in the movies, and... They don't really... We haven't seen a Forgotten Realms movie.
He probably yield upon finding out Brunor's rank of King of Mithril.
Yeah. Once...
So I'll give it to Brunor.
And the one who refound the forge in Galtabrun. That's fucking huge.
So I'll give it to Brunor.
Yeah, that's huge. Alright. Jump cut! Fuck, man, that was crazy. We were under heavy bombardment from Chaos Forces. And Vox Links went out. We got a Servo Skull up and running, sniped by some distant cultist. I don't know what the fuck happened. But anyway, so we're on to the third battlefront, my friend.
The third legendary battle will be Marvel's Thor versus DC's Zeus.
Ooh. Marvel's Thor versus DC's Zeus. I would say Marvel's probably given Thor more of a bigger power set than Zeus. Zeus is like Superman strong. Thunder. Man. That's a hard one.
Isn't it?
Maybe. Yeah, I would have to probably give it to Marvel's Thor. I think just because he has a on a more brutal power set, I would say.
Yeah.
We haven't really seen Zeus do, like, the... make the bad decisions. Like, Thor has.
True.
What's your opinion, then?
I would have to give it to Zeus. Zeus is the head of a pantheon, father of Wonder Woman, who could probably beat Thor, or at least stand, like, hold her own against Thor for a tie.
I don't think. I think a couple hits of that hammer to the face and she'd be out.
The hammer's crazy good, but she, unlike most of Thor's villains, actually has trained with weapons.
Yeah.
She's got a crazy magic shield, and...
Yeah.
But this isn't about Thor versus Wonder Woman, it's about Thor versus Zeus.
Yeah.
Zeus is the head of a pantheon. And even in Marvel, that's a huge deal.
Yeah, yeah.
Kind of puts you above the rest of the gods.
Yeah, even in all of Marvel, the people that hold high ranks of power in places are usually badass to tangle with anyway. Like Doctor Doom, Black Panther, it's people that fucking not ones to fuck with.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, I'm going to give it to Zeus.
Alright. Yeah, Thor is, in Marvel, Thor is a little bit more of a follower.
Yes.
Than other people. Gotcha. All right, we're going to move on to the segment of the show we call WYSIWYG. Segment of the show in which we take a different personality, item, and organization from media, comics, and pop culture and thrust them into the grim darkness of the 41st millennium and see how they fare. First up this week we have the Master of the Universe himself, He-Man.
He-Man, a.k.a. Prince Adam.
Prince Adam, you know, little wink to everybody, you know, like nobody else knows.
Yeah, we do.
We do.
Should we incorporate also his tiger?
Cringer slash battle cat?
Yeah.
I love my battle cat, but I say no.
Okay,
he's good on his own.
Okay.
He-Man himself.
He is ridiculous enough on his own.
Yeah, he is.
Can throw mountain ranges.
He can
throw a mountain range. The fact that he can pick up a mountain range is ridiculous. Because the... it would just break where his hands are.
Exactly. But
he can pick up and chuck a mountain range.
So he's got the...
He threw a rock.
Like Superman.
Yeah. He threw a rock at a moon. And the moon shattered into small enough pieces that they didn't even burn up on re-entry.
So, alright. So he just, like, can pulverize a planet with a rock.
He's a living exterminatus.
So you say he's taking on a Wraith Knight.
He could take on a Wraith Knight. He's taken on giant robots in the past and simply picked them up by their foot and thrown them across the continent.
So, okay, so you could take on a giant robot. So he's...
He has strength.
So strength is... of course, so he's got... I think he'd say Wrath of Impact. He's
impact,
a big dude.
Yeah.
He's not as tall as a Marine, but probably about as thick. Dude's gigantic.
Far stronger. Far faster, too.
Really?
Yeah. Superhuman speed and agility.
Okay, alright. So, he would be weapon skill 4 or 5, then?
Weapon skill 4 or 5, because he doesn't really fight, like, traditionally. He will grab you. Most of his fights are he grabs the person, holds them over his head, says a one-liner, and then throws the person.
Okay.
Usually across the horizon.
Like, they're like, oh!
Yeah.
We're so far that they slowly descend.
Yeah, yeah. They don't get hurt. No.
They
don't even show them landing. It's just, they're a speck still in the sky in the distance, and then they're out of sight.
You see them come back around, fuck you, He-Man!
Yeah. You could probably throw a person into a perpetual orbit.
That's awesome. All right, so he's better than a Primarch.
Physically.
So him versus the Emperor. Psychically powered.
The Emperor also has reality warping levels of ridiculousness. But it depends on what stage of Emperor we're talking about here.
I think it would get really dark when he... Like, the Emperor would be willing, as we've seen, to...
Yeah, like the Emperor will get up after being thrown across the planet. And then, like, I'm going to...
Ass. Yeah, yeah.
And
I
probably
want to rip
still
space
get thrown
off.
Across the planet a couple of times. I mean, the Emperor was almost defeated, killed by an orc.
It's just a power sword that he carries, am I right? It's called the Power Sword?
It is the Power Sword, and it is far more than just a 40k Power Sword, sadly.
Do you think he can gauntlet that and just crush it with his adamantine gauntlets?
Probably not.
Okay.
It, like, has proven to be near indestructible in the show.
Okay.
Like, beyond, He-Man can't destroy it. If you can withstand He-Man's ridiculous, I throw a rock. One-handed toss.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Why isn't everything just crushed to dust in He-Man's hands?
Ridiculous, like, levels of self-control.
Like Lenny of a Mice and Men, just with everything, though.
I hugged my sister She-Ra, and she exploded.
Alright, so let's move on. He would fare fucking amazingly.
Yeah, he would do quite well.
Probably
the rest of the Masters of the Universe, totally not.
No,
but
not in that.
But him,
man, he faces no. Done. Yeah. One sniper, each one of them heads. Oh, flip!
Yeah.
This right here takes him out. Cup of Christ from Indiana Jones.
Last Crusade.
Yes, the Remembrancer. He breaks into the cave. Right there, the old guy's like, "This is a cup you must choose and drink. Choose
wisely."
Regal.
Wars would be fought over this thing. Over its mere existence.
It's like the Spear Longinus. It has that guarantee of something in war. Like, you can live forever, guaranteed. Here's the cup. You can win, no matter what, if you have this spear.
Would they try to use it on the Emperor? I mean, I know the High Lords of Terra wouldn't.
They definitely wouldn't. They'd be like, fuck that. That's like, if we decided to have a king again.
It depends on whose area it's discovered in. If, like, the Sons of Dorne found it, any of their subchapters. Alright, we're going crusade again.
This is kicking back up.
Hey, Gollyman, we figured out a way around your thing. Loophole!
Yeah.
They bring back, they have the Corpse of Velimont.
Yeah. Dude, you know how many Primarchs? I think Vulcan as well is in stasis. In
Vulcan is, may or may not be in many pieces. It's highly suspected by the community aware of it that Trazen the Infinite has a decapitated head still alive and screaming. It's far too large to be a regular human.
Well, in the last book I read was Vulcan Lives. He rides, I forget how he shows up there, but he shows up on Kalth. McCrag, right after Kalth. And the lion shows up hunting Kurz, and Kurz has been torturing Vulcan, and just killing him over and over and over again, and he finds out that he's perpetual, and he's like, holy shit. I kill him in worse and worse ways, and he just keeps coming back. And Vulcan just keeps, like, going a little bit more and more and more and more nuts. And John Grammaticus,
familiar.
Yeah, he's another perpetual working for the Cabal. Is on spoilers if anybody's currently reading that book.
But it's been out for a while.
Yeah, so he ends up stabbing Vulcan while he's in a fight with the Lion, Kurz. And everybody's fighting, all in this one group. And Gilliman's there. And he gets stabbed in the heart with this...
Arrow
that's made of a lightning bolt that was made solid of the Emperor. From the Emperor. So, somehow, like, a lightning bolt struck and somehow it became solid and they made these arrows out of it. And he gets stabbed with it. And now he's in a perpetual stasis. So they don't know if he's alive or dead. So according to that, last thing I've read in Fluff, I would say
a lot
they could
of
have bring him back
that
as well.
Put pieces together and assume that he is in several pieces scattered throughout the galaxy.
It could be. He's
and,
a perpetual.
Like both the Salamanders and Trazen, the Infinite of the Necron fame, are looking to collect all the pieces.
Collect them all!
So, moving on?
Yeah, so we've got the Flash Rogues.
Flash Rogues.
Yes.
Good small time, terrible big time.
Yeah, they would not... Like, if they were like, hey, let's go up against this small group of Space Marines. Dead. Quickly.
couple mass rounds.
Yeah.
Captain Boomerang come out, you bink off their fucking Ceramite, and they boom.
Depends on whether or not they did their research, I think, as far as that, a small group of space marines is concerned.
I say, in these battles, I say they're on equal strength, well, they're not on equal strength, but they're on their highest, their best possible thing. And they always meet randomly. They don't. Okay. They haven't done their.
Okay. All right.
Their research.
So yeah, probably Flash Rogues then just get gun mowed down.
So I don't think they do better in schools of the assassins.
They probably do very well against assassins, individual ones. At least.
Enchantress could be a Kaluxis.
Oh no, I was thinking more about them keeping what they are and fighting assassins. Because the one thing about rogues is that rogues don't work for anybody. That's why the rest of the rogues don't really like Captain Boomerang anymore, because they consider him a sellout working for Waller.
I see them just, like, if they want to live, they would have to join an assassin school.
Or, it depends on what planet they end up on, all things considered.
That's true.
They end up on a hive city, they can just hide at the bottom for a while. Forever, until the day they die.
That's true. They would run some hive cities. It'd be good. Especially,
And like,
Boomerang,
no,
would have a valid place there.
Like, they could run an interplanetary system crime ring with the way Mirror Master can just go from mirror to mirror.
Yeah, that's true.
They'd fare very well.
Yeah.
Quite a profit if they're willing to adapt.
Yeah, they would have to adapt to hive city life, but I think as long as they don't get on the radar, they would do great. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we did hack out a little niche for the Flash Rogues.
Yeah.
All right, sir. I think you have a few.
I do have a few. All right. First, the character.
Okay.
Drizdo'Urden.
Drizdo'Urden. All right, so obviously he's got to go to either the Eldar or Dark Eldar.
Harlequins.
Harlequins? Yeah. And their Laughing God is kind of like up his alley, actually.
A little too sinister, most of the deities in 40K.
Yeah.
For his tastes, all things considered.
I think his god's a unicorn.
Ridiculous plot armor. If wherever he shows up, he gets put in charge eventually, just because he's that badass.
Yeah, he's tactically sound.
Yep.
He can lead armies.
Fighting in the Webway compared to fighting in the Underdark.
Yeah.
He did quite well.
Yeah, I think he would be... I compare a lot of the Dark Eldar to the Underdark, right?
Yeah.
So I think he would do better with Eldar. And they're still a little dark for his taste, the Eldar gods. But I think he'd end up running that shit.
He likes Isha.
I think it's the Unicorn God, right?
No, the Eldar gods. Isha is the Eldar goddess of life.
Oh, okay. Yeah?
Nurgle kidnapped her.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Naughty things to her.
Feeds her soup.
This little blister penis.
Feeds her plague soup.
Okay, so yeah, Drizzt I think would do, but up against a space marine. Icing Death, twinkling.
Do you remember his fight against Ubald Mini Arrows, post-ritual that made him ridiculously strong, fast, and everything?
Yeah.
I imagine the same thing, considering
anklets,
magic scimitars.
Plus the anklets of speed.
He's quicker than the Space Marine.
Plus, Winnovar is part of his repertoire. Yeah, that's his kit.
Yeah.
He just, come to me, and she fucking, boom, wanted a Space Marine.
Yeah, he probably...
I think he might do it. I think he would be quick enough, too, to find the chinks in the Ceramite, you know, where...
Oh, he wouldn't need to find the chinks in the Ceramite. It's the same chinks that's in every armor. You can't design armor that you can move in without having
like the joints.
Vulnerable
yeah, yeah.
locations.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. He would quickly go, okay, I can't get through this armor there. In the elbows and all that stuff. And we see on all our models, they have exposed arms.
There's not plating there.
Yeah, exactly. You could just split that shit.
Yep.
But they have acid spit, which is always good.
They do have acid spit, but like most of the time they're wearing helmets.
Yeah.
Which is probably the primary reason why the acid spit is incorporated into the rules.
Yeah. That would be close combat. Like, at initiative one, you have a strength, like, 5 attack at initiative one. Alright, so Drizzt would be way badass.
Yeah.
Alright, so next one.
The group. The Marvel Illuminati.
Ooh. So we have...
We have
like Doctor Strange,
Doctor
right?
Strange, Professor Xavier.
Yes.
Iron Man. Reed Richards. Black Bolt, King of the Inhumans.
Oh, man. What's his name? Doctor Doom's in that, isn't it?
Nope.
And what about, the guy with the gem in his head? Isn't he part of the Illuminati?
Nope. Infinity Watch.
What's the guy's name again? I know people are going to be like, internet.
Adam Warlock,
that's it. That guy's badass. No, Adam Warlock. Mr. Sinister, that's what I'm thinking of.
No, he's not part of the Illuminati either.
Yeah. Well, he's probably got his own Illuminati that he made somewhere.
So, Black Bolt, Black Panther.
So, Black Bolt is Scream. That's like Psychic Scream?
It blows up mountainsides, starships.
Blow up a starship?
He can blow up a fleet of starships.
So a battle barge is fucked with Black Bolt's screen.
Yeah. And he can fly in space. So...
No, Chatty Cathy, though.
Yeah.
But, it's alright. Alright, so he would do great. Yeah.
Iron Man, we've already discussed, so we're gonna just gloss over him.
Yeah, he's a bitch.
Reed Richards... Actually knows how shit works. He would dominate.
The Mechanicus, you think?
If they don't kill him.
I see the Mechanicus, I think would want his knowledge.
Or they'd want to kill him.
I think they're... Aren't they always, like, for the betterment of technology first before...
Nope. They're for the betterment of their own political goals and power efficiency.
So, yeah, Richards would probably die then. Because he'd have a lot of good ideas, but he'd be like, hey, that's messed up, and they'd be like, die, bitch.
Same with Tony along those lines.
Yeah.
But unlike Tony, Reed doesn't like to make weapons.
Oh, the first time he put on the armor and he flew around trying to fucking fight any kind of space marine in battle tunic. Yeah. Anyway.
Alright.
So, the next thing.
The Necronomicon from Evil Dead.
Ooh. The Necronomicon. Plaktu Virakta
Nikto.
Necktie!
He said it.
Yeah, I clearly said the words.
So what do you think? Book that makes zombies. And you go crazy or go back in time.
I think that's easily like in the Space Marine movie. That's kind of like what that dude was making that Codex chapter into some sort of Necronomicon that makes demons zombies.
So standard warbot effect gets put in a vault.
Yeah, standard. Yeah, they kill all the demons, purge all the shit, and then
once your grimdark is grimdark enough, this isn't really a
big deal. Dude. It wouldn't be that big a deal.
Like the zombies would make a joke, and the Inquisitor would be like, "Oh, this is great."
Yeah, yes, the cocks in hell, and then be like,
"What's hell?"
Burn, heretic.
So that was my WYSIWYGS.
Alright, man, that's fun.
Like a bunny. Alright.
So, little known fact about He-Man before we jump into the next segment. Remember the guy, I believe his name was Orthos or something? The wizard?
Orko,
the wizard? You know, the big O on his chest. They gave him the name Orko afterwards. They were like, hey, I need a wizard character, I got this thing. They drew the big zero on his chest because there was a big joke amongst the animators that that's how much money they were going to make from any of the merchandising of all the original characters they were creating.
Yeah.
So it's a big zero. It's a big, like, laugh, like, ha-ha, we don't make shit on all this. Because basically they were given almost like the old comic book deals. Like, hey, if you want to animate, you can animate for us, but you have no control of any of the characters. These are all... It's a toy-based... cartoon show instead of a cartoon-based toy line.
With the exception of very recent cartoons, it has been that way still for decades.
I don't know, man. A lot of more things are like the intellectual property first, then the toy line comes afterwards. This is like a cartoon. It's like, I need a lobster guy.
Yeah.
We got a lot of lobster hands in the fucking warehouse, so make a lobster guy. They're like, alright, lobster guy.
Rock lobster.
Yeah, exactly. Now you got a monkey dude with lobster hands. It's so weird. So, if you're ever in the Jitsu Beach area, and you want to play games. I'm talking to you, but I'm also talking to you. You need to go to Dimension Dreamworks, too. It's an awesome place to go. They have an awesome staff. They have cool, knowledgeable people. A lot of community for games that you wouldn't believe. There's... I think I was up there the other night, and there was up to like 25 people playing Pokemon, and not Pokemon, but Yu-Gi-Oh. That's still a live community up and running. They have a big Magic night. They have a big Pokemon on Sundays. They have a huge Warhammer community. I think
there's a War Machine community as well.
A huge War Machine community, big Warm Hordes community. So they got a lot of people, man, that are willing to play games and willing to help you learn something if you want to learn, man. If you want to have as much fun as we have, if you want to learn to play a game, and that's what you do. You need to go to a game store and learn. Adventure DreamWorks 2 is that game store if you're ever in the area of South Florida. You can get a hold of us on Twitter at the Tabletop Talkerz. That's with an S, not a Z. Yeah, so it's at Tabletop Talkerz. Or you can go to tabletoptalk@outlook.com and you can email us. Or you can just leave comments at the end of this video and we'll try and get back to you and we'll incorporate it in the show. If you ask us questions, we might even do an audience question segment. We actually had one time, but it's been a long time since.
We did it in the past.
All right. So we're going to move on to a segment we call ScanBC. This is a place where we take the local Twitter feed of Vancouver, British Columbia, and we look for the stories that are purely Canadian. It's usually
lighthearted.
Yeah, very lighthearted, firemen, all kinds of different things. And the emergency, I believe, response tweets all this stuff out. So here we go. We're going to start off. ScanBC. Burnaby crews are responding to 600 Buckingham Avenue for a person that fell off a bike and hit his penis. Yeah.
Where was this crew when I was a kid?
Yeah, exactly. You know how many times I fell on that bar? You know, like I'm doing a jump or something, and I'm like, oh my god, it hit my penis. I can call 911. And they're like, we're coming right up. They got the RCMP bounties. Yeah. Remember, what was it? The Something About Mary?
Oh, yeah.
We got a bleeder. Yeah. How do you get the balls over top of the... All right, so the next one. Vancouver police. That's amazing, though, that you can get that, like, a response time on you hitting your penis. Your bumper penis, they're out there, they're making sure it's working again. That's what universal health care will do for you. Vancouver police are responding to 5600 Fraser for a robbery at a flower shop. Owner pulled a toy gun. The suspect fled on foot.
Toy gun.
Yeah, that's cool, man. I'm happy for him. The robber probably came in with a knife, because they don't really have many guns out there in Canada. So he comes in with a knife, probably. He's like, give me your money, eh? And the guy's like, well, he's probably got a dirty, hairy, like, copy. I'd like to think it was a Clone Wars blaster that he pulled out.
I'd like to think it was just an airsoft gun.
I'll get you right in the eye, fella. He's like, it's not worth it.
It's not worth the minor bruise.
Robbing a flower shop as well. Like, and for the owner to be prepared, he's like, I only need a toy gun for it.
What bad a neighbor. Is that like the flower shop in Final Fantasy VII? that's bad. That bad a neighborhood?
It's gotta be. Yeah, it's gotta be like the little shop of horrors, that fucking flower shop. Alright, so, next one. Surrey RCMP, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, you know, they do right, are responding to the McDonald's on 7th Avenue in King George for reports of a male that is tossed on the cookies on the floor. I thought he tossed his cookies.
Yeah, that's what I was just thinking. Is he using his euphemism for
it? It said all the cookies.
Oh, so he grabbed the cookie thing.
Yeah.
And threw it on the floor.
Yeah, just the cookies. He's like,
fuck you, fuck the cookies. Fuck your cookies. I want pancakes. That's so bad.
It's probably because they weren't serving breakfast. You know, it was like 11:35, probably.
Oh, but then they changed that policy. A lot of areas.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, not in his neighborhood.
I guess not.
Yeah. It was 11:30. It was 11:31.
Oh.
And,
11:29.
Yeah. I'm like, I'm sorry. We've already switched the menus. He's like, what? Man, look at that.
Still a minute left. There's some cooked over there.
Yeah. I'm watching her throw out the McGriddles. Vancouver police are responding to an address for reports of a drunk male banging on the door looking for a brothel.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's pretty much self-explanatory.
Yeah, he's drunk. thinks he's at a whorehouse.
But he's not.
He's not.
Wait, no, looking for a brothel?
It said he's banging on the door looking for a brothel. He might be just looking for directions. He's like, hey, do you know where that brothel is? The best little brothel.
You know
the
brothel on King George's? Am I on King George?
Listen, I'll toss all your cookies on the floor if you don't give me the directions.
Oh, we're
to
going to the story again.
Oh, yeah, we're going back.
Same guy that hit his dick.
Yep, same guy.
Goes get on his
he's
way.
He's mad.
Yeah, he's mad.
Yeah, that's why he's late for breakfast.
Why he's late for breakfast, throws all the cookies on the floor. Always a step ahead of the police, though.
Yeah, always, always. Now, all right, so he moves. He
gets drunk, looks for a brothel.
All right, so after he goes and looks for the brothel, Vancouver police are responding to Shanghai Alley. Now, that is awesome.
They have a Shanghai Alley.
Shanghai Alley.
I didn't think people named alleys anymore.
I didn't think they did either.
Like, especially after, you know, Crime Alley.
This has got to be in Vancouver's little, like, little China. You know, little Chinatown. So, police are responding to Shanghai Alley for reports of a male chasing another male with a sword in Shanghai Alley.
Oh,
this
man.
Could be the Big Trouble in Little China of Vancouver. You remember the big battle in the first, you know, like,
yeah.
They all come out, yeah.
And the Three Thunders.
The Three Thunders, yeah.
Man.
Yeah. I think, what's the guy, the character's name? I don't know, Kurt Russell. I forget his name. But
Jack something.
Yeah, Jack something. Like, well, listen here.
It was just being John Wayne.
Yeah, I couldn't believe that. Chase him with a sword. Either that or it's Duncan MacLeod. It's...
You think the gathering is happening in Vancouver?
It could be. I think they were just a little too late for the quickening.
West, the gathering.
Might have been Sean Connery. Chase him down with a shot.
Clancy Brown.
Who's your favorite Duncan MacLeod? Did you like the show?
I liked the show until the later seasons when they made it a little too Vision Questy.
Yeah,
he was sword fighting nothing.
I didn't like it when he had when the kid came out to be immortal too.
Yeah,
was like
it was a little
buddy.
Too sidekicky.
Yeah,
I mean they know they're eventually going to have to decapitate.
Yeah,
another.
And just like Batman, the it made it very the plot armor very weak at that point.
Yeah,
I
did like them testing the limits in the show of how much you know you could survive.
Yeah.
There were some really sad episodes, like the one with the mentally challenged guy who's been around since the Old West.
Yeah.
Who loved trains. I'm just going to leave it at that because we both watched the show. Sad.
When Batman first came on the scene, he was black and white, you know, very like, I'm going to fucking. Black
used,
and gray.
Used guns.
And yeah, he's just a brutal motherfucker, right? And then when they wanted to introduce Dick. They drew him gray and blue, and they changed his hue. They made him more lighthearted. They were like, "We don't want him so dark."
Kill the kids.
Yeah, exactly. And it almost was kind of like that with the show. Maybe they knew that more families were watching it together because I was watching it with my mom. My mom fucking wanted
off.
To fuck Duncan MacLeod so bad she couldn't stand it.
I am immortal. I have inside me blood of kings. Yes.
All right. Well, we've come to the end. Sadly, all the saves have been made, all the witches have been denied, all the scattered measured, all the pain not felt, all the challenges accepted, all the fear not known, and all the foes smited. This has been Tabletop Talkerz. Josiah, what's best in life?
Crush your enemies, see them driven before you, and hear the lamentations of their women.
God damn it.
That is good.